Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for choosing this session. I know we have a lot of great sessions going on at the same time. So really thankful that you have chosen this session. And so next 45 minutes or 40 minutes, we're going to talk about Lightning components debugging in general. So Lightning components has been in Salesforce ecosystem quite a while. And I've been following a community called salesforce.stackexchange.com. So that's where you will find a lot of developers and other people and people who go through a lot of challenges, they post their questions. So from past couple of years, I've been going through that forum. And what I figured out is, there are always workarounds for some of the problems that Lightning has. And, the real debugging power of Lightning components is something, that's not been well established or, that's been not been shown to the developers. So they've been going through certain challenges, and I thought I'll put that 2 years of experience of me spending time, on the Stack Exchange community with a session, like a 40-minute session where I'm going to show, what are some of the techniques that I've been using, to debug this Lightning components and get it on an App Exchange. So to introduce myself, my name is Mohith Shrivastava, and I've been working as a software engineer at Code Science. We are a PDO, product development outsources, and we are one of the master PDOs, been in the ecosystem from like past 9 years, and we have more than 100 apps on an App Exchange. So we build super complex apps on the platform. And I'm a Salesforce MVP as well. I got opportunity to work with the community, and I'm happy to be getting involved and contribute my best. All right, and thanks to the sponsors. I mean, this is a great event. I'm sure, I hope you guys are having fun here, and special thanks to all these sponsors. All right, so now let's get into the talk. Like, why is debugging, sort of important for, any programming language, right? So the faster you debug, the faster you get into the problems and more productive you are. And, that's why you start liking a language or, stop, coding in that language. It's the ability to debug, step through each of your code, go through each of the lines and look at, the variables between server and client side. So debugging is like one of the common things, any programmer needs to be successful and, on the platform. So I thought these are the common six stages of debugging that we go through, as a developer. Like, initial thought when we see a bug in the code, it's like, okay, this can't happen, We see at the code and like, this cannot happen or this does not happen. And when we realize it, right, and then we are like, oh, I see, this is a problem. And then we are like, okay, how did it work before, right? So that's like a common, mentality of developers. We go through this six stages of debugging, so I thought I'll mention this before we actually get into the core of the talk. So I'll spend some time, for how many of you are here, built a Lightning component, like at least one component? All right, and how many of you are starting to are interested in knowing what is this component framework? Cool. Okay. Great. Thank you. So now, Lightning components have been around for 2 years now, and the reason why I think it's the future of Salesforce is because if you look at Salesforce product, overall product, right, offerings, like, for example, Sales Cloud, Service Cloud, Marketing Cloud, or, Heroku, or other offerings that Salesforce has, primarily the focus has been to make everything in terms of components. Like, the web components, as in general, is, a great it's in the revolutionary state. If you look at other frameworks as well, like React or AngularJS, everybody is trying to componentize your web page. Like, everybody wants to, develop in terms of components and not think through, a tab-based approach. Like, you click on the tab and don't want to refresh the whole page. You want to build your page as a single page app. What Salesforce offers with Lightning components is, again, a builder. Whether you're working in communities or, in your Lightning app builder, that's what I'm going to talk about. So it offers a nice way to actually drag and drop and build all these components and then arrange it. And your admins have this power of choosing, okay, which components I want and, what is that I want to see on the page. So that's a power that, the builder gives it. And to make it effective, there needs to be an ecosystem where, we'll need to build a system where we'll have a lot of Lightning components for everything, you know, for almost all the problems. And we are into that revolution, as we see the platform going forward. Like, everything is changing. There are a lot of ways to actually use Lightning components. I'm not going to go into detail, but if you look at Salesforce user interface, like, now we have a utility bar where it's a Lightning component. We have a quick action, which is a Lightning component. And then on the record detail page or the chatter group page, everything can be built using these Lightning components. And we are slowly moving towards that transition. So I thought, we will discuss this in a bit. What is a Lightning component? I mean, how is it different from Visual Force? Like, Visual Force has been around for like 2 years now. It's been like 4 or 5 years. But what Visual Force, the way Visual Force was designed and the way the Lightning component works, it's totally different. And that's why it's a drastic change for a developer to, even go through and understand, what is the major differences. So this slide is kind of, it shows us, what is it? I mean, in nutshell, what is a component? So a component is basically a bundle. So I'll just switch to my editor and show you what does a component look like. So in your, I'm using something called Visual Studio Code editor. So one of my colleague and a coworker, his name is John Nelson, he built this entire IDE on Visual Studio Code. The reason why I thought he built was because he found it's very cool to use, and it is probably the fastest editor currently. So why not build a plugin, to interact with Salesforce and, save all our code and, do it. So it provides an ability to actually, get everything from your package, scaffold it, and then, just save all the resources or the code, to your server, and a nice editor as well to, go through the JavaScript code or the Apex code. So as you can see, I have a Lightning bundle here. Good examples are like all these folders that you see here are Lightning bundle. And in this, what happens is, so if I open a bundle, like let's open something called as maybe YouTube search, right? So every bundle, you will see a file like this. Like, we have a component file, we have a design file, we have a controller.js, we have helper.js, right? So whenever you spin a Lightning component, unlike a Visual Force, in Visual Force we used to have just one controller, and that is binded to your Apex layer. But the Apex layer is binded to your UI. It was pretty easy, and you could break it with Visual Force components, but most of the developers just preferred to write monolithic code. It was not so easy to actually manage the code base. But here, as you can see, we have, like, whenever you spin a component or start looking into a component, you get all these bunch of files. And this diagram, basically, it actually shows you, what are these components? Like, what is the role of each component? So just to summarize what happens is we have this component, which is a markup, which is an HTML markup, basically. It's just how you want your component to be to the user, like how it is presented to the user. And then you'll have a controller file, which actually works with the component. And then you have a helper. So in the helper, you write all the utility methods. We're going to dig into one of the components and actually look at practically how it looks. And then we have this design file where you can expose certain attributes for the admin so that, admins can configure certain things. And based on that, you can write your behavior or business logic. And then we have this renderer, which is basically to override, a DOM, override the rendering cycle, in fact. So in a nutshell, it will look like a spa app, basically. It communicates with Apex. So if you look at our component here, so let's look at this component, right? Let's go to the component markup here. So as you can see, we have this component, and we mentioned these interfaces. So, the implements actually suggest where exactly these components are used. Like, for example, available for record home means that, this component is available for admin to actually drag on the record home. And force record ID gives the context that, okay, what ID, this component has access to, or the context of that record. And then we have for community, so if you want to expose that in Salesforce communities, if you want to expose this component to the Salesforce communities. So all these things, and then we'll go through all this, what is register, how do we handle all these things here. And as you can see, there is a markup, right? It's a plain old markup. You can use Salesforce design system to prototype your application in terms of components, and then break it down and have this markup in terms of the component. And then you'll see that it is actually binded to a controller. So here, probably, I think I have a result card. Here you go, so result search. Yeah, so this is binded to a controller. So this is your Apex controller, right? So this is binded to your Apex controller, and Apex controller writes your business. Like, that is where we write our business logic, just like how we write for everything. And if you look at one of the Apex controllers here, so let's go to the Apex controllers. So YouTube search. So if you look at Apex controller, we have a method here, actually, which takes certain parameters, returns something. So in this case, I'm returning a class or a wrapper class here with YouTube data parser, and actually calls a YouTube system and, you know, gets the data, parses it, and then, you know, pushes on to the helper. So if you look at this helper class, the helper class is where we say that, okay, which method I want to call it, right, in this class. So this is the method called search. So this is what I call it. And then what we do is we pass the parameters. So as you can see, the parameter name and the Apex parameter matches. You know, that's how it understands what parameter it's going. And if you have a list of parameters, you just write them. And then you do a callback. Now, callback is something that's commonly used in JavaScript, actually, so that, you know, whenever a function completes, you want to take that result of that function. Now, that might be an asynchronous function. So we have this callback where we say, okay, after this callback, just execute this. So once this function gets executed, what we do is we actually use this concept of set and get. So we define something called as attributes. So I'm going to show you what is an attribute here in a while. So attribute is basically like a container or, you know, a data binder between your controller and the markup. So what you do is you define an attribute. For example, I define an attribute, and that definition can be a string, or it can be an integer, or it can be a complex data type like, a custom class here. So here in my case, YouTube data parser is like a custom class that I've built. So this is like a pure custom class where you can model it, or you can model your layer. How do you want it? Like, you know, what are the attributes that you want it? So for example, here I'm calling a YouTube server, YouTube API, and then I'm getting the data, and then I'm actually converting that data into an object like this, you know, into a class like this. So you can model that, and you can actually use that. What is a little bit weird is in other frameworks, you actually don't have something called this attribute like this, you know, where you declare an attribute on the markup. You either declare it on your, you know, JavaScript, but this is like, you know, you declare your attribute right inside your component, and that becomes your data holder. So basically what you do is you go back and you set it. Like, for example, here, I just say that, okay, whatever the data is being returned, you know, you just set it with, you know, this data. And then that is available for me, and then I can pass it to another component. So in this case, I'm passing all the items, you know, all the iterations that I'm getting, and passing it, and then, you know, I have another component where I actually pass each of the items, and those are actually getting displayed. So let me show you what, you know, how this works actually in the org, and before we jump ahead and go into the debugging. So let's preview this app. So this is what the app I was talking about. Yeah, so it's, I've used like Lightning Design System. You can find all these cards and menus and stuff like that, you know, in Lightning Design System. And it is inbuilt. You don't have to import any style sheets and things like that. Now, you know, if you put it inside the app builder, or if you define, you know, an app with a particular extension called Force SLDS, you get all the design systems. You don't have to worry about importing it, and you just follow the class and the conventions to, you know, build some quick prototype like this. So what it's doing is, let's say I want to search something and I click on this. What happens, as you can see, whatever I'm typing, you know, it goes from this. So this search widget itself is a component, so that I can use it for other things, like, you know. So that's one component. And what it is doing is, it is actually, so whenever I type something, right, I release an event. So this is also event-based programming. So what I do is, we have an application event. So I just fire that event. And this whole, the other section actually listens for that event. And then it calls the server, which is my Apex method. And then what we do is, we actually parse the data, and the data comes back. So most of the times it is a simple flow like this, you know, where you will call the server, you will get the data, you'll do the data binding, and, you know, most of the times if you are doing some complex things, you manipulate the DOM, or if you are building some charts and things like that, then you use third-party libraries, which I'm going to talk about. Like, you know, it's not that easy actually to use a third-party library inside this bundle. There are certain things we need to take care of it. And when we come to that, I'll talk about that. So this is, in very simple terms, it is always communication between server and like Salesforce server and your markup. And in between, a lot of things can happen. You know, you might miss something in your code, and you don't know why is that variable not coming, or you know, why is this particular error happening. Like the errors that we have seen with this has been like very, very weird, and they are slowly filling up the gaps. So let's actually look at one of the errors, and this is actually, I'm going to skip through some of the slides because we're going to. So this actually, this is all. I mean, we can go through this. I mean, we use ES5. I mean, still the compiler doesn't support ES6, so we follow ES5 specifications of JavaScript. As I said, it's a component event-driven model. You know, it's a pub/sub model, so you can loose couple your components. On backend, we use Salesforce Apex. And this slide kind of puts together like what are the things that are available. Like if you go through the framework, it's pretty complex. I mean, you can, and it's pretty powerful as well. Like, you know, you can do implementation of something like an abstraction or encapsulations and things like that. You know, I'm not going to go deep into that because this is not like this is not a session where I want to cover what is Lightning components. Instead, I want to show how to debug it. But you can actually go through the developer guide, and you will see. You know, in nutshell, it's. You know, you'll have attributes, you'll have methods, you'll have events, you'll have component bundles, and a template. Like you can create a template and then extend that template as well. So let's actually go into debugging now. So let's take an example of a common error that I've seen, like which has flipped me many times, and it still flips me, but I'm no more it's no more unknown to me. So let's open our. So everything here, I have a Git repo. I'll share with that. So all the code that I'm using is available on the Git repo. So you can clone it, or you can go through it later. So for example, let's actually take a look at this component, like account component with error, right? So what happens actually? So let me actually open this. Open selected. There you go. So this component I built, I'll show you the code. The reason why I built that was to actually show you a pretty much a niche use case. So what I'm doing here is I'm not doing anything here. In fact, there is no markup. I'm just calling this init function. So the init function gets called, and it's calling the helper function. And that's how the component boots up. You always have this init. You know, you can write this init handler and call an action, which calls the controller here, and the controller calls the helper. So helper is like calling an apex. So it's just calling this throw error apex, which I'm going to show you now. So throw error apex is basically just throwing. Let's actually get into the class. So apex error. So I have this method, which actually I've done nothing here. I've just extended the exception class and throwing an exception. Now let's look at what Lightning does to this. I mean, simple use case where, so this example is like, in real world, you can consider that, because there is a trigger error, or let's say there's a DML exception, or a SOCL exception, or a user permission access exception. There are so many kinds of exceptions that you can encounter. Let's see what happens, actually, when I do this. So let's preview this. So I'm throwing an exception called as user-defined error. Now, when I actually inspect it, and I'm actually inspecting what is the error that's coming out, you'll see a JETI exception like this. Like, look at this. I mean, this is not even something that, you're aware of as a Salesforce developer. I mean, so what is this? I mean, it shows an internal error ID. I mean, what is this internal error ID? I mean, it showed the error that I defined here. I'm saying user-defined error, but why is it actually throwing me these many things? And this is the first thing that flipped me. I mean, anything that happens on my server, I mean, anything wrong that goes in my Apex, I'm seeing an internal error on my front end, right? So what is this? I mean, how would a developer debug this? I mean, only way I can look at this is, okay, so one of the ways I can obviously look at is debug logs in Salesforce. So I'll go here, I'll say debug logs. So let's actually put a log for myself. So this is how we put the logs in Salesforce. If you have been with the platform, this is like 101. This is how we debug a lot of things. And actually, let's run once more. There we go, the exception. There we go. Let's see the log now, what happens here. So it shows me in my log, I do have the exception, but on my front end, you know, for a front end developer, he is not aware what is happening. So it says my exception here at the back end, but on the front end, it is, you know, it's something that, you know, you can handle it and say that, you know, it's an internal error. Like even to read this and, you know, display this, it's not so easy. So let's see what Salesforce actually has in the documentation, which is something that, so let's actually open another thing that, so this is how I handle the error and show you that. So let's actually go to this. It's very easy to read here rather than reading there. So we go to Apex error handle. So I'm just calling another method here. The same sort of a code, it just makes a call. It just calls another function here. And the class, let's go to the Apex actually. So the Apex class is here. So this time I just returned something inbuilt by Salesforce called Aura handled exception, okay? So this is like an inbuilt thing that is provided for the Aura. And let's see what happens actually when I actually run it now with that particular thing, with error handled app. Preview this. It's not going to do anything. There's nothing in it. So I'm going to go here, look at the console. So look at this. So now it has automatically figured it out. So as a best practice, what I figured it out is, okay, anything that you write in Aura handled method, just encapsulate it within try and catch. And your catch block basically will have the statement of, you know, you will have the statement of Aura handled exception, and you will put the exception inside that. So any method, any Aura enabled method will be, you know, encapsulated within that, so that front end, when you are looking at the front end, you exactly bubble up the exact error and not an internal error from the Salesforce. And especially if you're working in projects where, you know, your JavaScript is being built by a developer with JavaScript skills and your backend or the Salesforce Apex is built by a developer with Apex skills, you want to keep that segregated, or at least, you know, make this one available to the front end person so that, you know, it makes sense for him to actually analyze it. In the backend, it's very simple. I mean, debugging is very simple. You put the system.debugs, you know, the regular Salesforce we have been following, but always make sure that, you know, you encapsulate try and catch, and the catch will return an Aura handled exception so that we can actually trace back what is happening. Because in a real world scenario, there can be a lot of things that can error out in server. So this is the thing that I want to show. Now, how many of you are actually JavaScript developers here in the room? Like, really, you're JavaScript? Oh, great. Yeah, nice. So for a person who is doing an Apex, you know, JavaScript in itself is a pretty complex thing, you know, because of the language. What happens is, if you are an Apex developer, you are used to that strongly typed, object-oriented kind of a language, where everything is strongly typed, and most of the times you see what is an error right away, you know, during the compilation. Even runtime errors are easy to figure out with Salesforce system.debug. But with JavaScript, it is, you know, the language can be written purely functional. You know, JavaScript is not pure functional language, but you can write it in terms of pure functions and keep your states, you know, manageable. But it is a change. It is definite a change, because you can accept a function, return a function, you know, and call a function within a function, concatenate functions. So it's a functional, it becomes a little functional, and the way we imagine functional and asynchronous programming is not the way we think in an object-oriented programming, you know. Unless you have worked with threads in Java, you know, it's a little bit difficult. I mean, when I started with JavaScript, you know, a couple of years or 3 years back, I started with, you know, small concepts like what are promises, callbacks, and things like that. So it is a little bit difficult to actually debug, and when you are coming from Apex, pure Apex and Visual Force programming, it's little change, you know. So let's look at, so what I'm going to show you is, let's actually come back to our app, the app of the YouTube search that I have, and look at the inspector. So to help debug Lightning components, right, if you know JavaScript debugging, then it's definitely going to help. I'm going to cover some of the debugging tricks that I've been using actually to debug. But apart from that, we have an extension, Chrome extension called as Lightning, Lightning Components Debugger. So I suggest you to actually download that and have it in your Chrome extension. It only works with Chrome browser, but it is great because I'm going to show you some of the features actually that it provides. So we have time, no worries. So, okay. So you will see this so the moment you have, you will see something like Lightning on, you know, apart from all the options that Chrome provides, we'll also see something called as Lightning, and then we'll see this bunch of things, which I'm going to talk about what is a component tree, what is a performance, what is transaction, what is event log, action storage, how are these going to help us, right? So first basic thing is, if you have a complex app with so many components, that is where the component tree comes into picture, because it helps me imagine, okay, what is the tree structure? Because everything follows a structure, right? So that's what the component tree basically does. It does nothing, but it gives you a sort of a nice tree-like structure of your component model. And as you can see, I have this YouTube search app, which has this search widget, which is my top widget. And then we have this YouTube search. And then we have this aura iteration, and we have each of the cards actually rendered, which in itself is a component, right? Now, what are the other additional things we can do here, once we trace the tree of our entire structure? So for example, let's say I'm on a YouTube search, and I want to find out what is the markup that YouTube search has, right? So we go to the console. Let's do this. So first it told me, okay, this is a markup type of YouTube search, you know, when I did this command called rattemplus, equals. This is a pretty standard command. And then what I can do is I can also see, okay, get me the elements of that. So once it gives me an element, it actually gives me the actual DOM behind it. So, you can actually split up the DOM. If you're a designer, it becomes very easy to actually go through each of them and see, okay, are my tags getting rendered properly? Are my style sheets getting rendered properly? Is my data and the links, everything is coming proper or not? That makes it a little easier. The interesting thing that I use it quite often is to debug the data, which is, let's say I'm on a YouTube search, right? And let's say I want to inspect what is coming in this data attribute, right? This is what my helper is setting, or this search string is what my helper is setting. How can I actually say, okay, what is there inside that data attribute? I want to see as a developer, I want to see what are the values that have come, right? So what we can do to do that, again, remember that I'm actually clicked on that. You will have to actually click on that. Then it makes the selection. And then we go to the console, and then we can do this. We can say aura.temp.get. So you see, it exactly gave me the JSON structure. Let me actually clear this. Clear the console and do this and see this. So you see, all my objects, all my forefront objects, and what are the things my front end is consuming with the object definition can be seen here. So you can literally go into each one of the attributes and see what is the data that's coming out, with this command. It is quite useful. I use it a lot. Sometimes you see, okay, this is like a backend server dev, you have not coded this variable, and sometimes it's like, okay, is it coming on the front end? Why is it not coming? So it's pretty powerful. You can do something like, let's say I want to get a search string that I have typed here, so we can get that as well, right? It's pretty cool. We can see all the attributes of all the components that we have. We just need to know that it's an attribute that's been defined in your markup, that's pretty handy actually. The other cool thing that I use quite often is a performance, right? So I want to know, okay, when I click on this, so you have to click this red button. I always keep forgetting. So when we click on the red button, and that's where we actually start seeing the thing. So we can click on this. So this is very helpful when you have more components, more nested trees, to find out, okay, which component actually took a lot of time, right? What is the component? Like, let's look at here. So what happened in this is, so aura component as a whole took like, probably it took like 40.1 milliseconds, and self time was like 0.2 milliseconds. And then we look at and we break up each of them. Okay, what time did this RIHTML took it up? And you know, so where is my search expression? Let's see this. So the whole component bundle. Let's actually stop this, clear this, record this. All right. Let's actually get inside this. There you go, there you go. All right. Yeah, so what this actually does is you can actually step through and see, I mean, the performance-wise, it's most of the times I've seen that, you know, if there is one curve that is going too much, then I know exactly that, okay, my problem is exactly in this component, you know? So I can step through, debug it, and see, okay, what is it making it more performant? Like, you know, what is causing it? You know, maybe there's something I'm putting inside the loop in my front end, you know, that I should avoid it, you know? Or there is something that I'm doing which is causing the recursion. Like, what happens, what I've seen most of the times is when you actually name your, you know, sort of your apex method and your helper, same, everything goes in recursion, you know? So we actually name it differently. This is one of the errors that I've seen commonly. Let's look at other things. So this is like a transaction that I was talking about. You can actually see what network time it took to debug more. Like the search component, it took these many seconds and whatnot. Event logging, right? Event logging is really essential because here, when you have multiple components, you can actually get into a lot of uncertainty of, okay, which event is actually publishing it, which is actually listening it, right? And, okay, is the event actually firing it, or there's a problem in the listener? Because at runtime, at compile time, what happens is we don't actually save it. It doesn't give you compile error. Like, if you don't put your registers or handlers, let me show you what registers and handlers are. So if you look at the search component, right? So I'm handling an event called search event here, okay? And search widget is probably the component that on the top it actually fires an event. So you see, I register an event here, and you would see in the controller I would have fired an event. You know, this is how you fire an application event. And then in my handler, you would see that I would have written a handler, you know, because I want to handle that event. And then in my controller, I would have handled that event somewhere. Yeah, so let's see what I've done. Yeah, so handler is like initiate search, and that is what I call basically on handle. So I handle that and then call a function here. So we want to trace back actually what is happening to our events, right? Let's see the time. Okay, so to do that, what we can do is we can set this up, and let's say, even the system events, like the key showed up here, that I did a key up events. Now, when I actually call my server, you see all the bunch of things that happened, everything got shown here, and C search event was the one that I was firing, and I could look at, okay, what is the parameter that I was passing to this event, right? So it says, okay, this is what it is passing, and then I can switch, okay, what type of event it is. Is it a, so it, it usually shows it's an app event or a component event. And then what we have actually is more cooler than that is actually we also have a, okay, let's see this. So we can debug it multiple number of times, however we want. It shows all the events that are happening in the system. And yeah, so this is the one, the toggle grid. I don't know if you can see this, okay. Let's see the toggle grid. Let me actually push it up a bit. I'm sorry. So toggle grid is basically, so are you able to see these grids? I am able to, but I don't know how do I actually. So it basically, this is a graph, okay? This is sort of a graph which tells, okay, what event fired after what? And, you know, is there a event that got handled? You know, with all these colors. So there's a color schema that you can find in the docs that say, okay, if this is of maroon color, it means it was handled. If it was blue color, which means it was not handled. and you know this fired after this event, so there is a dependency between that. So all this dependency graph can be traced, and in fact it shows here, you know, what are the changes that happened, which was the component that was handled. So it is pretty useful information to always debug, you know, debug this event when you have a lot of components on your page. This becomes like a handy. It shows, okay, the key up event fired, and then the search event fired here, you know. So it gives you a sort of a tree, an event tree basically, to help us debug. So that is one of the things. And I want to talk about actions, actually. Okay, so let's talk about those actions. So this tab is pretty cool, actually. So what it does is, so let's say I am searching for something. Let's say I initiated this action. So it keeps me a log of, okay, what are the completed actions? Let me clear it up so that we can see it clearly. Yeah, so let's say I started searching for it. So it showed me, okay, so this is the action that got executed. So this is server actions, okay, or the server or I enabled method that got called. It said that, okay, I have a parameter that was these actions successful, you know, is it a storable? So storable is basically you want to cache some things on the browser. So is it a storable action? And, you know, it gives you all sort of information about the action. Now, what we can do with this is, what I generally used to do it is, so let's say I want to see in my code, I want to actually step through, let me go to the helper. So this is the helper. So let's say I want to actually step through this error, you know. I want to step through the error block, which, you know, I'll have to actually, to simulate that in Salesforce, probably I can write test class, but on the front end, right, I still want to simulate this to see how my UI behaves, you know, once this goes into the error state. So what I'll do for that is, so what you can do is you can take whatever the action you have and put it here, okay, in this pending override. And what it does is you have this options, like, you know, what do you want to do with this, you know, with this action next time, you know? You want to fail it? Okay, let's fail it. So we say, okay, now error response next time. We say that, okay, just, you know, throw the error. So what you can do here is we can say, okay, error happened, whatever it is. We can throw whatever the error stack you want. And this is helpful for designers because they want to see the error stack and then design their front end, you know, like how do we want to show all these errors and things like that, and you save it. So we got saved this. So now let's actually go back, call the action. You see, it went into my error block because my error block said alert the error, right? So it went into the error block, and now you can see that it said, okay, it passed everything, but I was able to simulate that error. So you see? It actually errored out, so the state was error, right? So we can simulate such things, you know, with this. Like you have, let's say you have 5-6 actions on your page, right? You can actually drag and drop combinations of them and see, okay, what happens if this fails? What happens if this fails? What happens if these two, you know, actions succeed and these fails? So you can simulate all those things without having to go back and forth in the server and changing anything on the server and then design it. You know, very helpful for JavaScript designers and, you know, UX designers. In fact, the UX designers that I work with, you know, I show them all these things, and they're able to do pretty cool stuff with that. You know, you have to just talk with them a bit and show them, like, you know, these are the possible errors, and, you know, based on that, you can give a proper experience to your users, you know, with this. The other thing I wanted to show is you can also do something called as override the result, okay? So override the result, what does it do? So when I say override the result, it starts giving me all the variables. So these are the variables actually that are coming from the backend, like the data attribute that we saw, or this Aura enabled class that we have here. Where is this Aura enabled class? Just give me a sec. So here it is, data passes class. So all these variables, right, that we saw here on the backend, now all those things are available to me as here as a key. You know. So what effectively I can do is, I can say, okay, so let's clear this guy. So what I can say is, let's say I want to run this. Okay, I ran this and then say come action override. Right, now what I can say is override the result next time for me. So let's say I want a different width or maybe a different height. I can say, okay, height. Okay, I want a different height here. You know, I don't want the height. Maybe I want like a 10 pixel height or whatever it is. And next time when I actually run through that, you know, there you go, the height got reduced a bit, I guess. Or, you know, I did something here. But whatever it is, I mean, you can actually go and literally override. Yeah, you can, I have 5 more minutes. Okay, cool, thank you. So, yeah, so what we can do with this is, you know, you can override every result that you have declared an object in the backend. You can literally override without having to go change your code at the backend and see, okay, what are the different values and the combination of the values and play around with the UI directly on the front end, you know, without having to go back and forth like this. So this is pretty cool. I just always use it every time. I'm gonna skip this in interest of time. Let's actually go into the other parts of the documentation. So yeah, the presentation is basically what I showed. It covers all the things like, you know, I was talking about the color schemes and, you know, I just documented some of the things, some of the action states that we have. And the other way is pretty cool to me has been, you know, using the debugger keyword. Debugger keyword is used in Chrome, I mean, in JavaScript very often, and if you're running a Chrome browser to actually see what are the values that are there and step through each line of the JavaScript code. So what I'm gonna do here quickly, let's see. So I have some debugger here. I can actually say, okay, open this debugger for me. So you can put debugger in your code, and as you can see, the save was successful. I mean, this IDE is amazing. Just you know, give a try. Hats off to the guy who built it. I mean, I just totally use this for everything now. I just ignored Maven's Mate and other things. I no more need them because it covers most of what I need. Especially useful for managed package builds because this has a scaffold. Like, the best feature of this IDE to me has been, like, you know, I say go to my command palette and I say, like, force code menu, and I say, okay, retrieve a package. It gives me all the packages that is there in my arg, and I say, okay, give me this package. So it just tries retrieving everything and scaffolds it for me. So I just build my package. Package takes care of all the dependencies, and then I say, okay, give me all those things. You know, this nicely splits up all the file. You don't have to worry about package.xml and all those things. So this is like a trick. So the debugger is pretty simple. Like, once we do this debugger thing, it's pretty cool, actually. So what we can do is, I'll just show you one scenario, and then we're almost there. So let's go to the console, console, and just do something like, you know, just do the action. So as you can see, you know, wherever it is debugged, it just paused my execution, and I can see the state value here directly. And then I can actually step through, like, okay, what is the value? And, you know, you can see the state value. If you step through further, it again stops at that point, and you can look at all the values that are there previously and all the functions and things like that. It's pretty cool. I mean, and it works with Lightning. That's great. So, yeah, set up debuggers in your application, break it into different number of paths, whatever you want, and step through each of your line of the code to understand what function, what objects. Even if JavaScript is complex in terms of objects and functions, you still see them all, you know. All right, so let's see how many more. I have 2 more minutes, and let's actually, it actually took more time than I expected. So I'll talk about, like, third-party libraries in Lightning. This is something that I see often in Stack Exchange, like, this library doesn't work with Locker. Can I find a Locker-compliant library, right? The problem with Lightning components is, so they have to support an ecosystem where, you know, none of the components step through each of them. So consider a managed package application, right? A banking application, and let's say another application, which is from your competitor. And both are running on the same page. You don't want the data to be, you know, flowing between those two components, unless and until that is intended. So that's where the locker service comes. That's where they restrict it and say that whatever the data you have, whatever the DOM you have, you cannot manipulate the outside DOM. And that's where it is different from most of the libraries. That's why you follow strict ES5 patterns, and they have one library called Locker. So if you go, that is also an open source library. So go on force.com and look for Locker. You will see a file. What it does is, so that is also loaded along with all these files. So what it does is it goes through each of your code and converts everything, like all the JavaScript objects, attributes, and functions, and converts into a secure DOM or a secure object. You know, and if you're using something which is not allowed, it just throws up an error. So we have CLIs to actually debug it. There's a great blog post that I wrote myself on that. I have a link for that in the presentation. So you can actually go through that. So short solution is, like, okay, before importing any library, just test it out into the Lightning component and see if that works actually, you know, inside the locker. And if it fails, then what you can do is you can actually go through why it is failing by comparing with that locker service file that is there. Usually those errors are one of those that you file on those on those lockers, you know? So the locker library, so can I take 2 more minutes?
Yes.
Oh, okay, sorry. Sorry about that. So let me show you something very quickly, and then we can say this is done. So let's actually go to locker service, force.com, or let's go to force.com GitHub. Sorry, I should have. Yeah, the Aura. So Aura project is completely open source, and maybe it will be hard for me to find the locker. Let's see if my browser is smart enough to tell me. Oh, there you go. So there is the file. So this is what happens actually. So this is all open source. I'm seeing pull requests. You can actually submit a pull request to Salesforce saying, you know, expose this. I mean, why is this not exposed? And most of the times I found that, you know, they are something that a developer has forgotten, or, you know, they did not worry about it. And, you know, that's why the third-party library is failing. So as you can see, you know, you can see the secureaura.js and everything. And most of the errors are actually thrown from here, you know. You can actually find them, like exception, maybe not. I'll show you actually one of the questions that I lately answered on Stack Exchange. I mean, that actually gives, locker, right? Say locker. Yeah, so this guy was asking, okay, you know, he used autocorrect attribute, and he was asking me, okay, why is this giving me this error, you know? So what I did is I just copied that error, went into that locker file, just pasted it in one of the files, and I found only these many HTML elements are exposed. And, you know, that element or whatever the autocomplete attribute was not there in this library, and that's why it was just saying that it's not secure. And we just submitted a pull request saying, oh, you need to add this as well. And Salesforce will actually tell us why. And in fact, they have the documentation. So if you look at the Aura documentation site, there we go. So if you look at the site, so this is where you have API viewer. So you can actually look at what are exposed, like, you know, secure window, okay, what is exposed in secure window? Like, you know, they document every bit of function that is actually exposed, you know. So it is a JavaScript over JavaScript, so it's valuable info. Like, you can actually go into it and see what is exposed, what is not exposed here, and if you are using one of those. All right, I think I'm done. Sorry for actually taking more time than I was supposed to take, probably 10, 15 minutes more, and I'll definitely share my presentation and the GitHub repo.